hey everybody, this is my passion project. This is something I've been wanting to do just about my entire life. It's only been within the last couple of years that I've had the equipment to approach, even to begin to approach to do it the way I would like. This is a project that I'm never truly going to be happy with. Most of all because I do not like the sound of my own voice, but being that this is a one-man band passion project, kind of had no choice in that matter. The other thing is that as I was making this, I found it almost impossible to get adequate B-roll, which one of the major disclaimers when you're watching this film is that with the exception of General Banks and with the exception of Governor Warmoth, none of the people that are pictured in this video are of the people that I'm talking about. So it's just random people that kind of fit the time period for the B-roll. Much of the B-roll is just kind of like a visual placeholder. Now, I still consider this work incomplete, but I thought since everybody is at home, they want things to watch, I would give you 53 minutes of something to watch while you're in quarantine. So with me making it this far with this project, I have several people that I want to thank. I want to thank my wife for always supporting me in whatever I do. I want to thank my family for supporting me, my parents, my children. I want to thank Uncle Van and Aunt Donna for putting up with me. I want to thank Richard Briley, God rest his soul, but also like to thank Jack Peebles, God rest his soul, for giving us the work that they did to keep this story alive. But most of all, I want to thank my friend Greg Davies, who is an invaluable resource for the history of Wynn Parish. Without him, this project wouldn't have happened. I really want to thank him for agreeing to do the interview, taking the time to do the interview that made this project possible. Also want to thank him for taking me around to the different sites, you know, the cemeteries, kind of the tour of Wheeling in Atlanta that helped make this possible. Much of this story is legend. I'm not putting a lot of this out there as reliable historical fact, but hopefully the way it's presented that you can tell the difference between the two. And above all, I hope you enjoy it. I hope you learn something from it. And any feedback that you can give me about this, whether it be positive or negative, will help me improve it and will be greatly appreciated. So enjoy. The Nightriders. None of their names conjure any images in the American consciousness. The likes of John West, Laws Kimbrell, and the countless victims they left buried in mass unmarked graves have no place in textbooks in America. No epic novels or Hollywood blockbusters starring cinema action heroes have been done depicting the life and times of the Nightriders. So who were the Nightriders? Well, if the legends that have been passed down by five generations of folks in and around Wynn Parish, Louisiana are true, they were the most prolific criminal organization in America in the late 19th century. They committed more murder and robbed more people than the likes of the James Gang, Billy the Kid, and other notorious Old West outlaws. Or so says a compilation of legends compiled by Richard Briley in a 1963 book. My name is Marcus Norwood. Join me as I walk the old Harrisonburg Road to dig up old bones of forgotten characters and chase the ghosts of the Nightriders down through these piney woods. In this film, we will examine the legends around the Klan and try to separate fact from fiction. Sometimes I can still smell my grandmother's cooking and hear her and my aunts singing old hymns, sitting together in the evening, shelling peas on my uncle's back porch. Country living was filled with time spent fishing, hunting, and enjoying the outdoors. My older family were figures from a bygone era that embodied the good things about the culture and history of Wynn Parish. This place has great people, but like any other place, it has spawned some not so great people. For better or worse, one thing that has always defined this area throughout its history is poverty. Wynn Parish before World War II was suffering in extreme poverty that's difficult to comprehend. History has shown persistent poverty has consequences. It can make people desperate, and it can make people angry, forcing them to do things that they might not ever imagine in better times. This story of the Nightriders is a story of poverty, a story of men struggling to return from the horrors of war. It's a story of despair, and of those who would rise to put things right again when no one else would. The Nightriders were said to have operated in Wynn Parish, Louisiana, just after the Civil War, with their reign of terror lasting from roughly 1865 to Easter Sunday of 1870. They made their homes around the communities of Wheeling and Atlanta, Louisiana.
Fresh off of its defeat in the Civil War, Louisiana would enter a period of turmoil as white residents resisted efforts at Reconstruction and violently struggled to maintain its economic and political dominance over the recently freed slaves. Whites violently suppressed efforts to provide civil rights to freed blacks, which would be demonstrated by a series of Reconstruction-era massacres and lynchings. To make matters worse, the region had suffered a scorched earth campaign led by Union General Nathaniel Banks. Herds of area livestock had been decimated, barns had been burned, and returning Confederate soldiers found it difficult to reestablish themselves and make a living for their families. Even if a man had a means to make a living, there was very little currency in circulation to be had.
After the Civil War, when John West, the Kimbrell brothers, all the local guys started coming home that had fought in the war, they came home to a very devastated parish. Wynn Parish was poor then, is poor now, but it's like Mr. James Hall Emerson once said, we never knew what the Great Depression was here because we lived through it before it happened, during when it happened, and we're still in it. But Wynn Parish was relatively poor. We didn't enjoy the big fertile land plantations. Wynn Parish was never a real large slave area, but some people did own slaves, and the Kimbrell family owned probably 18 slaves, which put them in a financial class of what one could consider wealthy at the time.
Whites bitterly resented the intrusion of who they considered carpetbagger Northern interventionists. After the Civil War, federal troops placed an occupying force in Louisiana. In order to feed the troops, supply trains were sent to garrisons placed around the state. Desperate and starving citizens raided these supply trains. In retaliation, the army carried out punitive raids that further inflamed hatred of the federal occupiers. In response to army raids and the general slide into civil disorder, upstart vigilante and political terror groups like the KKK, the White League, and the Knights of the White Camellia were formed for local protection. It was a response to a punitive raid on Wynn Parish that the Nightriders were established. The Nightriders would form around an inner circle of Confederate veterans. One of the inner circle leaders was a red-haired man known to the people of Atlanta as John West. Before the Civil War, West lived in Texas under his original name of Miles Weston. He was implicated in a murder robbery, so he moved east to Wynn Parish under an alias. When the Civil War broke out, West served in the Confederate Army and was attached to the 27th Louisiana Infantry Engineers. West was said to have a commanding and engaging personality. West was also known to be personable and had a kind of command presence. John West was a justice of the peace in Wynn Parish, the superintendent of the Sunday School in the Methodist Church in Atlanta, and a member of the Masonic Lodge in Montgomery, Louisiana. All of these offices would have meant West had a distinguished and respected place in local society. Another key partner was Laws Kimbrell, the son of Dan and Polly Kimbrell. Like John West, Laws served in the Confederate Army during the Civil War. Laws formed a friendship with Dan Dean during the war, a relationship that would one day lead to the downfall of the Nightriders. It is believed that Laws and Dan fought together at the Battle of Shiloh and were captured, spending the remainder of the war in a POW camp in Pennsylvania. Laws was known for being an efficient and ruthless gunfighter who had no compunction about murdering anyone.
Upon returning back home, John West, who was kind of a mystery guy, he took up with a Pennywell, a white lady who was from a pretty good-sized family that owned property in the Atlanta area, and they had quite a few slaves. And they had children together. What was not known at that time, though, John West had come to Wynn Parish on the run from Texas for some robbery or some crime he had committed. And Wynn Parish was part of Natchitoches, so the early records involving John West had to do with Natchitoches Parish, which eventually became Wynn. But John was a Confederate soldier. Jackson Lawson Kimbrell was Owen Struderick Kimbrell. All these boys served in the Civil War together, or in the Confederate Army. And as I said, when they got home, there just wasn't a lot for them. I think what probably, I'm not defending their actions because they did some bad things, but a lot of what steered them in the direction was they never got over the war. They continued to fight the Civil War once they got home. And there was always friction and tension between the Republican radical group that was in power. I had a great grandfather was disenfranchised because he'd fought in Civil War for the South. The white Democrats were disenfranchised. If you'd fought in the war, you couldn't vote. And that led to severe tensions, led to the Colfax riot, led to the Coushatta riot. And a lot of Wynn Parish people took part in those riots where a lot of blacks were killed. And it was all due to political situation at the time. John West was somewhat of a bad guy, apparently. I think he got disciplined in the military when he was in the Confederate service. He was put in the brig for either being AWOL or some deed he'd committed. But all in all, the Kimbrells and West and a lot of the returning Confederates formed what was sort of a home guard after the war to defend against the army of occupation as they saw it. A lot of people have tried to put race into the equation, and maybe there was some racial issues, but I know that the Kimbrell brothers all had children by black women. Those kids are listed in family Bible records. The Williams brothers, their uncles, they had children with blacks, openly lived with them. I don't know if the idea that the West Kimbrell clan was a racial group, that's just not true. I don't think they discriminated on who they may have robbed or killed.
A very old and well-traveled route known as the Harrisonburg Road runs through the southern region of Wynn Parish.
The Harrisonburg Road is the western extension of what is known as the Natchez Trace. The Trace's origins go all the way back to pre-colonial America and was a route originally used by Native American tribes. Native Americans would mark the path by notching trees. After North America was colonized by Europeans, the path was adopted by settlers migrating west in hopes of a new start on undeveloped land. Standing here on a portion of the old trace, you can still see the result of decades of wagon trains that cut a depression into the land. One thing to keep in mind is that by today's standards, the infrastructure in Louisiana was comparatively primitive. The trace was devoid of permanent bridges, paving, or drainage. This lack of modern engineering made travel slow, difficult, and often perilous. The still virgin pine forest of Wynn Parish and occasional marshland made for perfect cover for bands of robbers and villains who could waylay unsuspecting travelers and then quickly vanish into the dense forest, far away from established authority and quick-acting law enforcement. Wynn Parish's remote location made it difficult for area army garrisons to pursue the Nightriders with any effectiveness. During the summer dry months, the Red River and its tributaries would be at its annual low, which made it favorable for travelers to move west without being encumbered by swift streams. The Harrisonburg Road would have regular travelers who had to pass right by the homes of John West and the Kimbrells in Wheeling.
Well, the old Harrisonburg Road came right through Wheeling. It's been called the Natchez Trace, San Antonio Road, St. Augustine Trail, Three Notch Trail. It was a very important road during the Mexican War. U.S. Grant, Jefferson Davis, Zachary Taylor, Jefferson Davis, most all of those people that fought in that Mexican War travel that route. It was probably the premier east-west route going to Texas, which a lot of Wynn Parish settlers were going to Texas. And they got here and either the Dugdamonte was flooded or some waterways were flooded, so they just set up and homesteaded the land here. But the Harrisonburg Road, east and west, it was an east-west thoroughfare. And a lot of people were headed to Texas, a lot of foreigners coming and going, and you know, people that were trying to get to the land of milk and honey, which was Texas, free land and all that stuff. And the Kimbrells, of course, made their living off that road, and it was just an easy, people were, that came down that road were an easy mark to be robbed or murdered. And a lot of people disappeared and never made it to Texas. I know right after the Civil War, Uncle Charlie Crew, which was an uncle on my wife's side, he'd gone off to war. I think three of his brothers, maybe four, had been killed. They didn't know where he was. He made his way back to St. Maurice, which was right on the Red River, and was on his way to his mother and dad's, which their place joined the Kimbrell property. And he was thirsty, naturally. It had walked 5 to 6, 7 miles, and there was a common well there on the side of the Harrisonburg Road where people would stop and get water. And when he dropped the bucket down in there, the waves flashed in the well and a hand was sticking up. And Uncle Mutt Tilton said that he immediately bolted, run into his mother's house. She saw him coming down the lane, as the old people called it. And she ran out to hug him, and he ran right by her straight to the well and got some water. He was just famished. And then he came back and he told his family what he'd seen in that well. And I think that was probably the first discovery in the area that something was awry when that body turned up. And then they started finding other whales that had bodies in them. And a lot of times they refer to a whale, we think of just a drinking whale, but oftentimes just an area that was cut into the ground where you corralled horses and all that. Old people would call that a well. It was a safekeeping place. But the drinking wells, they found several skeletons and bone, human bones and such in those wells. Of course, the Harrisonburg Road eventually stretched over to through Manny, Natchitoches, and then Manny, and then on into Texas. You need to remember that the very western part of Louisiana and the very eastern part of Texas at one time was called no man's land because there was a territorial dispute between the United States, Mexico, and whoever. And the actual first capital of Texas was just southeast or southwest of Natchitoches, at Las Adeas. But a lot of the outlaws, ne'er-do-wells, people on the run, fugitives, would get to that area and they were kind of protected because there was no real authority of law there. So a lot of outlaws would come through this area or come through that area of the Harrisonburg Road. And they lived about 5 miles from John West, who also lived on the Harrisonburg Road over closer to Pacton. So that whole stretch from across Wynn Parish on that southern end was the Harrisonburg Road.
Although the Nightriders existed in an impoverished area, they were not drifters or otherwise marginalized people. The Nightriders were comprised of respectable members of society, even high-ranking local officials. It was headed by an inner circle. It was this inner circle that carried out the actual murder and robbery of travelers along the trace. When people think of post-Civil War outlaws, they think of drifters who rode free, robbing banks and trains, engaging in open, honorable combat against other armed men, and basking in the glory of fame given to them by journalist and dime novelist. West and his clan sought another path. They preferred to ride only under the cover of darkness and prey on travelers along the trace that offered ample reward but posed little or no risk of a struggle and would not draw unwanted attention. Another favored method of crime was to approach travelers and gain their confidence by extending hospitality and assistance. The Nightriders would then draw them into their homes or to an out-of-the-way location where they would be disposed of quietly. Early on, at least, West and his associates avoided confrontation with locals in order to prevent the arousal of citizen resistance. Law enforcement in Wynn Parish in this era was under-resourced and in a kind of malaise. Journalists of the area were often reluctant to name names and shied away from reporting on violent crime of any variety.
I have found documentation from the National Archives of West and Kimbrell overtaking the sheriff in North Louisiana, either in Bienville, Webster, Claiborne Parish, a prisoner that was being taken in, and them hijacking the prisoner from the sheriff. They had a pretty wide area of travel. I think basically what they would do is somebody coming down the pike down Harrisonburg Road, if they had good horses or mules or a wagon or goods, very little hard money then, I think they'd take, if it was an easy lick, as today's criminals call it, I think they take advantage of it. Many of the things that I've compiled over the years about disappearances of people and all. You can find some writing in some maybe newspaper about it having happened. I think what people fail to realize, there was no communication back then. The Harrisonburg Road wasn't backed up with travelers. You know, they didn't have traffic jams. You may have a settler coming through. I mean, someone traveling through. It wasn't back-to-back-to-back wagons, you know. You look up, and here comes a wagon, a family, and it's kind of a shock, you know. It's like traffic back here where we are today. There's just not a lot of traffic on this road, you know. Mm. Down there, the Harrisonburg Road, it was well-traveled, but not by droves of people at one time. So I'm sure it was a crime of opportunity, convenience, when they would strike. Vera Ferguson Smith, who recently passed away, told the story of when she was a young girl, her grandparents had a black lady that worked in their home. And she had worked for the Kimbrells, probably could have well been a slave. And she told stories of having to clean up blood in those cabins they had, or houses, or whatever, after they'd kill someone. I'm sure that, you know, some people think, well, they killed 300 or 400 people. I doubt that. I think that's extremely high number. One's enough. But I'm sure they killed several over time. I know there's documentation after the war, during Reconstruction, the U.S. government convened a panel to congressional panel to investigate conditions of the South. And I've got copies of those records where John West and the Kimbrells were mentioned in some of their outlaw stuff. I think they had arrest warrants out of Natchitoches Parish for 2 or 3 killings, you know, not 30 or 40. So how widespread they were, we'll never know. All we know is what we believe from Mr. Briley's book, which I think is a great resource with some shortcomings. National Archives, Freedmen's Bureau reports, newspapers from around that covered the stories. You just have to mesh that together. But we do know this. It was important enough to make most of the national newspapers when they rounded them up and killed them on Easter Sunday in Atlanta that day. It was big enough that the legend, no matter how small or how big it got, the legend and the facts were still there. I mean, it happened. So I'm thinking that where there's smoke, there's fire. And we've got, you know, the minutes of the Masonic Lodge where Dan Shoemate told them about the lieutenant being killed. You know, that there was a lot of legend behind that for years. And then young lady that runs the genealogical and historical section in the Wichita Parish Libraries. She found all the write-up on the Lieutenant Butch killing. So a lot of this stuff is documented. Briley just probably didn't, he was getting it from word of mouth rather than he didn't have access to all the things we do today.
Other Inner Circle members included Leck Ingram, who was a Wynn Parish constable, and Dan Kimbrell, known affectionately as Uncle Dan, was the Kimbrell family patriarch and husband to Polly Kimbrell. He was the father of Laws, Shep, and Billy Kimbrell, all major players in the Inner Circle. The Kimbrells had a store, were postmasters, and their home served as a roadhouse for travelers. The Inner Circle was supported by an outer circle of scouts, spies, safe house operators, and operators of blacksmith shops that handled the processing and sale of stolen properties, especially the repainting and movement of stolen wagons. The Klan also had members that handled the movement and sale of stolen livestock. At its height, the Klan was reported to have between 150 and 200 members. One of the primary goals of the Klan was to avoid discovery by killing and disposing of all traces of victims that they had robbed. The disposal of bodies, if done by traditional means, would have presented a challenge for the Klan, being that the digging of graves would take time, putting them at risk of discovery. The Klan solved this problem by digging wells that were placed periodically along the trace. Victims would be robbed, killed, preferably by cutting their throats, anything of value taken, and bodies cast into the prepared wells. The disposal was fast, reducing the chance of discovery. Klansmen would evaluate their victims, even directing them to houses where their prospects would be evaluated. The Klan also employed a system of signaling through the use of hunting horns. The horn blast would identify the location and size of various travelers. If the Klan needed extra manpower to overcome a large group, they could easily be mustered by the chain of hunting horns. In order to identify each other at night, the Nightriders used passwords. One surviving password is, "The clovers are blooming," to which the other Klansmen would reply, "Spring is here." If the correct password response was not given, it would mean instant death. It is impossible to enumerate how many travelers were victimized by the Nightriders. If Briley's tales are to be believed, then they murdered 300 or more people, while more reliable records indicate less than 20. It is my belief that the truth is somewhere in between. The proceeds from all of these crimes were managed by a man known simply as Mr. Williams. According to Klan legend, Williams served as a court reporter and then judge for Wynn Parish. He would go on to open a store in Montgomery, Louisiana. Williams served as a legal shield for the Klan from what little local law enforcement that existed, and laundered Klan money and arranged transactions for stolen items.
I vaguely remember what Mr. Briley wrote about it, that there was indeed an inner circle. Robert Carnahan, Bob Carnahan, an old cousin of mine and my wife, he found in the old Kimbrell Bible a little key, a hand-drawn key that was supposedly listed by one initial, members of the inner circle, which I'm pretty sure it was the Frame brothers, the Kimbrell brothers, West, and just a few more that were. But I think from what I can gather, the Klan was open to any returning Confederate or community member that felt as though they were being dealt a bad hand. Rape, robbery, pillage from the occupying forces that had come in and took over the South. I think the bad deeds were narrowed to those in that inner circle. that didn't trust most people. Just imagine the American Legion takes in all veterans, but then you've got a little core group that does the dirty work.
One of the more disturbing stories surrounding the Nightriders, and this is where I think the Nightriders really stand out from other groups of their time, is in the story of Aunt Polly. Aunt Polly was the wife of Dan Kimbrell. According to the legend, Dan and Polly committed their heinous acts even before the formation of the Nightriders, dating back before the Civil War. I can remember listening with an added sense of horror of the calm and calculating ways in which Aunt Polly carried out her brutal murders. Aunt Polly was a wife, mother, and active member of the Atlanta Methodist Church. Aunt Polly's persona was that of a temperate woman of her time period. To strangers, she had a kind and welcoming disposition. She would treat people like she had always known them and open her house and offer hospitality of the highest order. Dan and Polly ran a saloon in Wheeling, Louisiana, and their home served as a tavern and lodge for travelers. It was said that if a family was judged to be a valuable target, or if a family approached Dan and Polly's home, Dan would lead the man of the household to another location on the home place and quietly murder them by having their throat cut or with a killing blow to the head with a pole axe. Polly's job was to welcome the women and children into her house where small talk was engaged in and oftentimes a meal offered. Polly's preferred means of killing was by cutting the throat of her victims with a favored curved butcher knife. So numerous were the occasions of this, she became concerned with the time spent cleaning up the blood from her clothes and floor. According to legend, she trained her daughter to hold a pan under the bleeding victims as to reduce the amount of blood needed to be cleaned from the floor. Due to their proximity to the Harrisonburg Road and the frequency of unannounced visitors to their home, Dan and Polly developed an efficient method of murder that was discreet and easily concealed.
But, you know, I had an old cousin that was fairly close, much closer to the Kimbrells than me. And he always said that he thought Polly had a very mean streak in her. And that she had a great influence over her boys, that her boys could do no wrong. Now, if in fact, she committed some of the deeds she did, and through some family stories, I have reason to believe that she did. She was a very, very mean lady. Probably much more so than the old man Dilson Kimbrell was. Keep in mind, though, they went to church, they went to Sunday school, they ran the post office, they ran a store, a boarding house type situation. They were pillars of the community on one side. The other side, pretty rough from what you gather, what you may read. Oh. And from some things I've heard.
One of the most brazen crimes committed by the Klan was the robbery and murder of a U.S. Army officer who was en route with a military payroll. In Klan fashion, the officer was killed, his horse hidden from view, and clothing burned. Records from the Freedmen's Bureau, newspaper articles found in a Washita Paris newspaper, and military correspondence found in the Library of Congress gives us one of the most well-documented incidents in Nightrider history. The story centers around a young, energetic, and idealistic Army officer known as Lieutenant Simeon Butts. By all accounts, Butts had a sincere desire to make a difference in the lives of freed slaves and do his duty to begin the process of healing the country's wounds from the long and costly Civil War. Butts was last seen on July 7, 1866. He was setting out on a trip to deliver an Army payroll that consisted of $2,700. This was a date that was early in the Klan's history, but it would go a long way to establishing their destruction. Eyewitnesses observed members of the Nightriders following Butts just before his disappearance. The Army's primary suspect was Billy Kimbrell, son of Dan and Polly Kimbrell. According to clan legend, Butts was followed by John West and Leck Ingram. When Butts stopped at what is known today as Yankee Springs, West shot him in the back of the head. He was stripped of his clothes, and then his clothes, saddle, and other effects were burned. His horse was hidden, and the $2,700 payroll was taken. Later, his badly decomposed remains were found touching off an investigation, and warrants were issued for Billy and Laws Kimbrell. Laws would spend much of the rest of his life on the run from federal authorities.
The way that the Klan was eventually exposed, Dilson Kimbrell was a member of the Masonic Lodge in Montgomery. He had been a member in Winfield when they first came to Wynn Parish. And John West, though I can find no 100% convincing record that John West was a member of any lodge around here, he allegedly was a member of the Masonic Lodge. Jackson Lawson Kimbrell, the oldest boy, the surviving boy, he became a Mason at Montgomery Lodge. And I would say about the time, it was not long before the Atlanta Easter Sunday Massacre, the lodge in Montgomery met. According to those minutes, un-Masonic charges were leveled against Laws Kimbrell for deeds, just un-Masonic conduct. There had been some issues between members of the lodge, and a committee was appointed to try and sort those differences out. Didn't work. Someone came forth and testified that they knew that Laws Kimbrell was involved in the killing of Lieutenant Butts, who was a Freedmen's Bureau U.S. Army payroll guy that traveled between Trenton, which is West Monroe, and Natchitoches, where the headquarters was. He traveled the old military highway, which came from out of West Monroe today, across Jackson Parish, across White, into Wynn, across the Doug DeMona at Yankee Springs, what's now known as Yankee Springs, because that's where Lieutenant Butts was killed by the West Kimbrell gang. Dan Shoemate went to the lodge and told him that Laws Kimbrell had admitted to him his role in killing Lieutenant Butts. Now, Butts had left Natchitoches and stayed at the what we call the Protho Mansion, the St. Maurice Mansion, which Dr. Bolt owned at the time. He spent the night there, and on his way to Vernon in Jackson Parish, he was murdered in Ward 10. They now call that Yankee Springs. But his body was later found, investigation played out, and of course everybody knew it was the West Kimbrell clan that killed him. But Dan Shoemate reported that to the Masonic Lodge, and they called for a trial for Laws Kimbrell to be expelled from Masonry, but it didn't. The trial never came off because they had the firing squad at Atlanta shortly after that, and Laws escaped to Texas.
Prior to 1870, the people of Wynn Parish were reluctant to act. The Nightriders robbed and killed up and down the Harrisonburg Road, seemingly unchecked. But their increasingly emboldened actions reached a breaking point, and the Klan would be violently put down on Easter Sunday of 1870. In the months leading up to that fateful day, a young girl and her parents had been murdered by the gang near the Prescott cotton gin and mill, which had outraged the community. This outrage was further stirred by the murder of two families who were traveling the Harrisonburg Road from Franklin Parish. The gang didn't spare women or children in this incident, as chronicled in a Ouachita Parish newspaper report. A mob would be assembled to bring the Nightriders to justice in a manner that was not entirely civilized, but no less effective. The stories surrounding the events of Easter Sunday 1870 are heavily laden with legend that were described in Richard Brierly's Tales of the Klan, but what we know for certain is the execution of the Klan made national headlines in papers all over the country. Local people sought the help of a Confederate veteran and known gunfighter, James O. Mabin. The mob would also include a Klan member known as Dan Dean. Dean was reported to have been an old war buddy of Law's Kimbrell and had recently had a disagreement with John West, which had put him in fear of his life. Legend holds that James Mabin took a steamer to New Orleans, where he was given an audience with then-Governor Henry Clay Warmoth. During Reconstruction, the governor was not allowed to raise a militia, so it has been claimed, though no actual record exists, of Warmoth giving Mabin 25 blank pardons for whoever brought the Nightriders down. Klan legend also tells of two boys being held hostage by the Klan in order to gain leverage on Dan Dean. One of the boys was Dean's younger brother and beloved classmate of a group of schoolboys who attended the school in Atlanta. Klan legend states that the boys were active in raising arms and assistance to act on their own to rescue their friends. All of the accounts agree that West and several key players in the Klan were cornered at the Collier store in Atlanta and were led away to a field where they were executed by firing squad. Their bodies will be carried to the nearby Methodist church and buried in a mass grave. Klan legend holds that John West was standing on a stump attempting to calm the crowd when he was shot twice in the neck, with the second shot decapitating him. The legend goes on to state that his head was left on that same stump where it sat for years. Then his skull was moved into the Collier store before being placed in a grave in the Atlanta cemetery. Years later, a grave marker was placed in the wrong location. I found it fitting that when we went to see West's grave marker, it had been pulled up out of the ground and leaned up against a fence. Estimates of the number of men killed range from 7 to 20. The only person who emerged from the affair unscathed and in a good position was the bookkeeper Williams. Klan legend states that when he became aware of the mob activity in Atlanta, he rushed to John West's home and carried away the strong boxes of gold. After a cooling off period, Williams would purchase prime farmland in neighboring Natchitoches Parish and would become a wealthy planter. Laws would escape execution, but his actions would eventually catch up to him in Texas.
Dan Dean, who had, he was very close to the Kimbrell boys and probably even West at one time. Dan has been portrayed as a hero through the years, and I'm not too sure how heroic Dan was, because I think he was probably a major part of the Klan at one time. He and West had had some bad blood, and I think maybe even tried to kill each other. And eventually, I think West may have kidnapped Dean's parents or some of his family. And that's what really, the straw that broke the camel's back. People in Atlanta banded together, and they went after West. And of course, they rounded several alleged Klan members up and brought them to Atlanta, and West was killed, and several others, seven or eight, depending on the story. And they were taken across the road to the Atlanta cemetery. They wouldn't allow them to be buried inside the cemetery at that time. They buried them on the outside in a mass grave. Grand jury was convened. They sent Mr. John Abel to Atlanta to hold an inquest, and nobody would testify. Nobody would admit knowing anything, hearing anything, seeing anything, and I'm sure he was just as happy, and so was the locals. That story and the West Kimbrell story made almost every major newspaper in the United States. I've got articles from 8 or 10 major. I mean, within 2 or 3 days, it was in California, Minnesota, New York. It was all over the country what had happened on that Easter Sunday.
The bulk of the Nightriders were now dead, and Laws was on the run in Texas. The bookkeeper Williams would avoid capture and be the beneficiary of a large portion of the loot accumulated by the Klan. John West's wife would flee to Texas, while the remaining Kimbrells would stay in the community of Wheeling, where their ancestors live on to this very day. Legend holds that Tom Kimbrell would live a long life of relative wealth from a cache of Kimbrell gold. The stories of the Klan would be closely guarded secrets, and the legends would be quietly passed down, only reaching some level of outside notice through the efforts of Richard Briley.
To me, the one of the most intriguing things is the way Lyles Kimbrell met his death. Of course, he ran from here, went to the hill country in Texas, was involved in stock, probably stealing horses or cows. But he and this Barnes fella, I never did understand that connection until I finally woke up one day and went back and looked at the 1860 census, and this Barnes young man was living right next to the Kimbrells. But they ended up out in Texas, and got in with these guys that were taking stock to the market in Austin. And Lyles went into town with them that night to eat and attend some function. And they get back to their campsite, and a guy named Joe Philpott was found murdered, and the $2,000 in cash in the strong box was missing. Well, they arrested several old Confederates. You got to remember, you had a Republican administration out there. They were probably wanting to get rid of every past Confederate. They didn't let them hold office. They didn't let them vote. It was a radical Republican appointed position, the governor was. So they arrested all kind of Confederate veterans throughout the ordeal. Eventually, they got around to this Barnes guy, and they charged him. And I don't know who ratted on who first, but he and Lyles both ended up in jail. Lyles escaped, makes his way to Oklahoma. Somewhere along the way, his brother Shep, Owen Struderick Kimbrell, Shep Kimbrell, joins him. The Texas Rangers, U.S. Marshals corner them up there. They have a big shootout. They bring Lyles back to Austin, and they hang him. He was not even at the scene of the murder, and he was hung for murder. The other thing that's intriguing about it, and this I got from the newspaper clippings out in Texas, when they hung Lyles, the rope broke. They carried him back up on the platform and hung him again until he died. Well, you know, when we were growing up watching Gunsmoke and Paladin and all those other great westerns, if the rope broke, that was an act of God and you went free. But they didn't let Laws go. They hung him again.
The story of the Nightriders is not merely some amusing and intriguing tale of 19th century outlaws. It is an instructive and cautionary tale of the effects of poverty and the effects of war on the psyche of already desperate men. The story of the Nightriders is also a challenge to maintain our humanity in the face of overwhelming despair. I can sit around a fire late at night amongst the wind-perished pines and almost hear the Nightriders blowing their horns and galloping down the lanes. The almost faded history of the Nightriders live on in the retelling of these old legends. In this way, I hope that my children stay connected to the past to learn its lessons, to be guided by the wisdom of better men, and forge a future where groups like the Nightriders need not exist.